morning about a journey that God places us on. I want you to look this morning to 2 Chronicles chapter 34. The story there begins with a young king named Josiah. The Bible says it gives us a glimpse of what it looks like and what it looks like for him. In 2 Chronicles chapter 34, verse 1, it says, Josiah was 8 years old when he became king, and he reigned in Jerusalem for 31 years. When Josiah became king of Judah, it was right around the 640 BC. The international community was a mess at the time because the Assyrian Empire had already gobbled up much of Judea and Israel. But in this time, they were actually kind of subsiding in power, and the Assyrian was diminishing, and the Babylonians were coming into rule. And Jerusalem was able for this little short period of time to govern themselves. And this is the picture I want you to get when Josiah comes into power. It's a different time frame. Josiah's grandfather was Manasseh, and his father was King Amon. Both were wicked kings. King Amon was assassinated. And so here we have Josiah coming to reign at 8 years old. In these first seven verses of 2 Chronicles chapter 34, you're going to discover a profound declaration of this youth who ruled more godly than his father Amon, and who ruled more godly than many of the ones that went before him. As we move along this path of discovery this morning, I want you to realize that God is calling us to be godly men and women just like Josiah. He chooses to hide himself. God chooses to hide himself in places because he wants us to pursue him. In the second verse, it says, in Isaiah 45, 15, it says, truly you are a God who has been hiding himself, a God and Savior of Israel. God chooses to hide himself so that we will go and look and discover. The word there, hides is a word meaning conceal, hides, covers, and even secret things. I wanted to compare it to what Jesus talks about in Matthew chapter 7. He says, ask and it will be given to you. Seek and you will find. Knock and the door will be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks the door will be opened. This morning, I want you to know this morning, the one who seeks will find. The one who seeks will find. Not the one who sits back, but the one who is aggressively, constantly seeking. My wife and I went and spoke at a church up in Lake Isabella some years back. And I remember that morning, and Pastor Mike said, hey, would you pray over the people when we're done? And I thought to myself, man, I don't really have anything to say. And the line grew and grew and grew. And then pretty soon, Connie and I were beginning to pray for people. And all of a sudden, because of their hunger, because of their seeking, because of this thirst within them, all of a sudden came out of us, all of a sudden began to coming things that we didn't even know about their lives, but God was sharing those secrets and telling them, giving them words. And I'm telling you this morning, it's the same thing with us. The amount of seeking you do, the amount that you have, that tenacity you have to seek is what you will find. If you don't have a heart that seeks, guess what? You are not going to find anything. The one who seeks finds. In 2 Chronicles, the second verse, it says there, he did what was right in the eyes of the Lord and followed the ways of his father David, not turning to the side, to the right, or to the left. Young people, this morning, I want you to know, look, this was a king who was given his kingship at 8 years old. And he chose right from the beginning that he was going to serve God. He was going to seek God with all of his heart. Some of you, God is already pricking your hearts to say, listen, come after me. You know, we talk about wanting to raise burning hearts. It starts with us as parents. When we are passionate about God, when we seek him with all of our heart, that goes down into our kids. They want to pursue that. Josiah, even though his parents weren't doing right, Josiah said, you know what? I'm going to choose my own destiny. I am going to do what God wants me to do. And God says the same thing for us today. It doesn't matter how young you are this morning or even how old you are, Betty Washington. God cares about that. You choose the path just of destiny, just like Josiah did. Josiah did not turn to the right or the left. He doesn't deviate from the path. It's a narrow road. If you find yourself being herded, following the crowd, Everyone's doing it. I want you to know that the wide and broad gate is the default gate. If you choose nothing else, you are going through the wide and default gate. It is by nature the one that you're going to go into. You will have to find yourself striving to get into the narrow gate. Proverbs says it like this, Proverbs 4:26, give careful thought to the paths of your feet and be steadfast in all your ways. Do not turn to the right or the left. Keep your foot from evil. He turned not to the side, to the right or the left. He turned not to this. I want to read this to you. He turned not to the right hand or to the left hand, but marched onward on the road that the Holy Spirit traced out for him. Though tempting voices called to him from many a side alley that seemed to lead to pleasant places. Men of God, I want you to know this morning, that's what God calls us when we stand in righteousness with him. Is it perfect? No. Look, Noah was not perfect. Job was not perfect. But God said, listen, these men are perfected in my eyes because they are constantly seeking. They have a heart after me. There's examples. It says this about Noah. It says he was a righteous man, blameless among the people of his time, and he walked faithfully with God. Of Job, it says this, have you considered my servant Job? There is no one on earth like him. He is blameless and upright, a man who fears God and shuns evil. I want you to know this morning, this perfected heart is constantly seeking and searching, removing and repenting, digging and discovering, anxious only for what lies ahead on God's adventure and Holy Spirit as he leads us. Pilgrim's Progress. I want to read you this part of the story. I think it explains what I'm saying today. It says this, I then beheld that they all, until they came to the foot of the hill, difficulty, at the bottom of which was a spring. There was also in the same place two other ways beside which came straight from the gate. One turned to the right hand and the other to the left hand and the other to the right. And at the bottom of the hill, but the narrow way lay right up the hill. And the name of the going up the side of the hill is called difficulty. Christian now went to the spring. He drank thereof to refresh himself and then began to go up the hill saying, this hill, though high, I covet to ascend. The difficulty will not me offend. For I perceive the way to life lies here. Come, pluck up, heart, neither faint nor fear. Better, though difficult, the right way to go than wrong, though easy, where the end is woe. There was also two others with him. And it says of these two, it says, the other two came to the foot of the hill. But when they saw that the hill was steep and high, and that there were two other ways to go, and supposing also that these ways would meet again with that up with Christian went, they on the other side of the hill, therefore, they were resolved to go in those ways. Now the name of those ways was danger, and the other was destruction. So one took the way which called danger, which led him into great wood, and the other took the way of destruction, which led him to a wide field full of dark mountains, where he stumbled and fell and rose no more. See, I believe these men of the old, they understood this path that we don't travel today. But see, Josiah did. See, the key lies with Josiah in verse 3. It says, in the eighth year of his reign, he was 16 years old. While he was still young, he began to seek the God of his father David. See, I want you to know this morning, God's giving us a new command. He says, Jesus replied, love your Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. And then he said, but seek ye first his kingdom and his righteousness, and all these things will be given unto you as well. See, there is an all-out assault against complacency in the Word of God. This seeking would be an all-out assault against the common. See, we hear people say it. I heard my wife talking about it this week. She was talking about someone. She says, well, this person, they love Jesus. They love God. Really? How do we display it then? If we truly love God, if we truly are lovers of Jesus, do we follow after his principles? Do we obey what his word says? Or do we just kind of flagrantly live it out the way we think it's supposed to be done? See, see, I want you to know this morning, there's a parallel scripture in 1 Kings chapter 22. There's also a story that mimics, it's the same one as Josiah here, and it says this: he did what was right in the eyes of the Lord and followed completely the ways of his father David, not turning to the right or to the left. See, it wasn't a half-hearted attempt. It was an all-in, fully obedient, fully resolved to do what God wanted him to do. He wasn't going to do this half-hearted. He knew that that wasn't going to work. He had seen his grandfather and his father. Their attempts were futile. He knew that there had to be something different, and seeking after God was that place. The next part of that verse in 3, it says, in the 12th year of his, he began to purge Judah and Jerusalem of the high places. He's 20 years old now. The Asherah poles and the idols. Have you ever found a nice way to kill a snake? I'm telling you guys, I don't know about you. I have never been able to kill a rattlesnake and look somewhat dignified in doing it. It usually looks pretty ugly, and I'm usually throwing things, and I'm scared to death when I'm doing it. You know, I'll try to get a hoe or a shovel, and I'm throwing it every which way, and he's still coming at me. I want us to understand there is no graceful attitude with trying to compress the sinuous neck of a snake. It is a very difficult place. This should be our attitude towards the things that want to invade our homes or our lives. See, we should have the same attitude that Josiah did. And yes, it does look violent at times. It doesn't look dignified when we're trying to keep the enemy out. This should be our attitudes of our homes. We should not be dancing around, playing around with the snake. And that's what Josiah was doing here. It looked pretty gruesome when he began to do this. I want to read how he did this. It says in 2 Chronicles 34:4, under his direction, the altars of Baal were cut down. He cut into pieces the incense altars that were above them and smashed the Asherah poles and the idols. These he broke into pieces and scattered them over the graves who had sacrificed them. He was doing something that was so much different than what we'd seen today. He says this: I wanted you to see the scripture. I want you to see the five things that he does under his direction. He tore them down. He cut them to pieces. He smashed them. He broke them to pieces. And then he scattered them. See, I think so many times in our lives, our sin is just kind of one of those things where we push it aside, but we don't take ownership like he did here and say, listen, I am going to destroy this thing to smithereens. And God wants us to be that way in our lives. And then he says this, I want you to know this, his actions were intentional and deliberate. In fact, the last two words there where he says he broke to pieces and scattered, it says he actually pulverized them, he threshed them, he crushed them, he ground them to powder, he tossed them and scattered them abundantly. He was definitely against this thing. So then in verse 4-5, it says this: he burned the bones of the priests on their altars, and so he purged Judah and Jerusalem. I thought to myself, did he really do this? Did he really dig up the bones, or was this just a figure of speech? Just like we always talk about how Jesus is telling us, what he's talking about is just changing our heart. No, or did he really literally do this? So I looked in 2 Kings chapter 23, and it says this, that Josiah looked around, and when he saw the tombs that were there on the hillside, he had the bones removed from them and burned them all to altar to defile it, in accordance with the word of the Lord proclaimed by the man of God who foretold these things 300 years earlier. It is very apparent to me that he did this. God spoke these things through a prophet 300 years earlier. You're saying, well, what are you talking about, Greg? Well, let's go to 1 Kings chapter 13. It says there, by the word of the Lord, a man of God came from Judah to Bethel. As Jeroboam was standing by the altar to make an offering, by the word of the Lord, he cried out against the altar, 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 this is what the Lord says, a son named Josiah will be born to the house of David. On you he will sacrifice the priests and on the high places who make offering here, and human bones will be burned on you. See, 300 years before that, God had already foretold that this was going to happen. He said, I'm just carrying it out. Remember the story of King Jeroboam. He had the prophet seized right after this. He said, seize that prophet. And as soon as he put out his hand withered. See, God was in control. God says, I will do this thing and nothing can stop it. As we move on to the seventh verse, I told you in these first seven verses, there's a lot. In 2 Chronicles 34:7, it says this, "And he tore down the altars and the Asherah poles and crushed the idols to powder and cut them to pieces, all the incense altars throughout." I want you to catch something here. I think you may miss this if you're not mistaken. He says throughout Israel. Israel, remember last couple weeks ago, I told you that the kingdom had been divided. Jeroboam and Rehoboam after Solomon. Remember, there was the Israel tribe on the north and Judah. Josiah is in charge of Judah. Israel is not even his concern because they're already under the control of the Assyrians. This would be like me saying, okay, I'm going down to Porterville. I'm going to go over to Tulare, and I'm going to wreak some havoc over there. Yeah, I know I do enough of it here, but I'll do some over there too. That's what he was doing. He said, listen, he did this through, and then it says, then he went back to Jerusalem. He decided, and I think there's a picture here that I want us to see. See, he hadn't even touched the church yet. He hadn't even touched the temple yet. He was still focused on the people and on the land. I said it a couple weeks ago. Yes, I want a beautiful church. I want us to have a building, but I want us to be spiritually fit before we ever set foot in a building. I want us to be so strong supernaturally in the power of the Holy Spirit, walking with God and obedient to God, that when we put our foot in that building, it will be as it was when we see here the rest of this story. Amen. So here we got all this. This man is not a slacker. He cleans house. He hasn't even started with the temple yet, yet he's already purging everything. Now he's 26 years old in verse 8. He didn't start at the church. He had purged the land. He cleansed the people. And then he turns to the house of God in verse 8. In the 18th year of Josiah's reign, to purify the land and the temple, he sent Shaphan, son of Azaliah, and Messiah, and the ruler of the city, and Johaz, the recorder, to repair the temple of the Lord his God. This is our blueprint for revival. The way we build church is we get purged, we get spiritually fit, we turn our homes upside down, and then we turn to the building. See, in this story, you'll see just in the verse after this, they began to give all that they had to the Lord. Even Israel gave to the Lord. All of them were giving to the Lord. And then God used that money to begin to change and begin to build a temple. The money this morning, I want you to know, it doesn't belong to you. It's the Lord's. We are simply stewards of it. And Hilkiah, the high priest, dispersed the money to where it should go so that they could build the temple as they were supposed to do. In verse 10, it says this, "And then they entrusted it to men appointed to supervise the work on the Lord's temple. They paid the workers who repaired and restored the temple." In fact, in this story, you'll find out that they really didn't even have a huge accountability. It was kind of, they just trusted. And I believe that God was doing something supernatural with these people. But then there's something significant happens in verse 14. It says, "While they were bringing out the money that had been taken into the temple of the Lord, Hilkiah the priest found the book of the law of the Lord that had been given through Moses." He did all this, and he didn't even have the Bible. There is a key here I want you to see this morning. Seekers. People who seek after the heart of God. The Holy Spirit leads them and guides them. Here in the midst of all he's done, he's but 20 years and he hasn't even had the word of God, and yet he's on the right course. Amazing to me. Because the Holy Spirit was leading him and guiding him. They discovered this in the temple under the rubbish. Think about that. How bad have things gotten when you go into the temple and you clean it out and you find the book of the law under the rubbish pile? Everything Josiah had done to this point, he had done by the leading of the Holy Spirit. Seekers and lovers of God, raising a burning heart, having that heart that chases after God at all cost. Wow, no book of the law to even guide them, but you look what God was doing in spite of it. You know what? I want you to know this morning, it is not Father, Son, and Holy Bible. It's Father, Son, and Holy Spirit for a reason. Now, some would go and take issue with this and say, well, are you diminishing the Word of God? No, I'm not. Because the Word of God is brought to life by the Holy Spirit. That's how we can be. That's how I can see my brother across the street here, Pastor Mark, how he's so excited about the Word of God every week when we talk and we pray together. It's because God has ignited that. The Holy Spirit has ignited the Word of God in him. How can you be more excited today than you were 10 years ago? It's because it's constant discovery. It's because new mercies every morning. It's new discovering in him constantly. The Old Testament version of the book of Acts is what I'm giving you this morning. 2 Chronicles chapter 34, verse 15, it says this, and Hilkiah said to Shaphan, the secretary, I have found the book of the law in the temple of the Lord, and he gave it to Shaphan. Shaphan is the king's personal secretary. And this is what happens. So he takes the book of the law to the king. Keep in mind, Josiah has done more than the kings before him to evacuate the enemy. He has done more things right without the word of God, and now he finds the word of God. And I want you to see what he says here. In verse 16, it says, then Shaphan took the book of the to the king and reported to him, your officials are doing everything that has been committed to them. They're doing what they're supposed to do. And then he says this, then Shaphan the secretary informed the king, Hilkiah the priest has given me a book. And Shaphan read from it in the presence of the king. Now when he read this book, Josiah felt the quick, powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword. He felt God's word that was like fire or a hammer that could break rock to pieces like Jeremiah talks about. This word is powerful. This word does not return void. It is sharper than any two-edged sword. And the fear of the Lord came upon Josiah when he read the book. It was just read in his presence. And all of a sudden he felt the conviction power of the Holy Spirit upon him. I want you to notice, Josiah does not, in the midst of this, he doesn't go, look what I've done, God. He just does this. And when the king heard the words of the law, he tore his robes. Why? Because when the word of God was read to him, it was like life. But it also brought death. Because all of a sudden he realized what his fathers had not done, what they had lacked, what they had missed. Josiah had every right. If he, in our day and time, we'd say, God, look what I've done. I've built this up and I've done this and I've been doing all these things right. Josiah doesn't do that. He says, I want you to know this morning, men, this is the response that God wants from us. It's humility. When the word of God is read in his presence, he tears his robe. Because he felt it to the quick. Bone into the marrow. It touched him. God wants that sense of, I want you to know that during this discovery, there is also what I call the depressive discovery. There are those times when God reveals to us maybe where we lack or what we need to change, where we need to excavate. And sometimes those are painful. But it's all a part of the process of discovery of him. It should excite us. When he gives us those highs, it's great. But when he gives us those lows, we should be just as joyful. Thank you, God. The road to discovery is littered with great places of ecstasy and fascination and depressive discoveries of repentance. 2 Chronicles 21. So Josiah says, go and inquire of the Lord for me and for the remnant of Israel and Judah about what is written in this book that has been found. Great is the Lord's anger that is poured out on us because those who have gone before us have not kept the word of the Lord. They have not acted in accordance with all that is written in the book. I see this all through the word of God. Nehemiah, Daniel, when they were godly men. But when the reality of the word of God and the reality of what has gone on before them, that reality, they owned it too. And Josiah does that here. And so he says, I want you to know this, real godly men realize they are undone before God. And after all that he has done, they remain in this place of humility. Seekers remain in a place of humility. Humility is a safe place. Seekers are humble. He humbled himself. He didn't have to be humbled. I want you to understand that with Josiah, he didn't have to be humbled. He humbled himself. He didn't have to be pressed into this place. The word of God coming to life simply humbled him. Tear your hearts and not your garments, Joel 2:13 says. Josiah did both. He did an outward expression, a representation of the tearing that was going on the inside. In verse 22, so Hilkiah and those the king had sent to him went to speak to the prophet Huldah, who was the wife of Shalom, the son of Tokath, the son of Hasra, keeper of the wardrobe. She lived in Jerusalem in the new quarter. It's interesting, he calls upon the woman who was responsible for his robe, the one that he had tore. He calls upon a woman like Betty. Why? And I want you guys to know, he had Jeremiah as a prophet in his time. But he chose Huldah. Why? Because he knew that she would intercede. See, there is a place in our lives where God says, listen, you need an intercessor. You need someone who will stand in the gap between you and I. He called Betty. Says, well, Betty, what do you have to say about this? See, there's images all throughout Scripture of clothing, the garment of praise, dressed for readiness, clothed, not soiled. She is responsible for his clothing. She is responsible. And think about this. You know, when ladies, when you get your hair done or when someone's working on your clothing, there's an intimate setting there. There's a lot more that gets talked about in the hairdresser salon in town than probably any place else. Why? Because it's a place where you're freely able to talk. How many times did Josiah and Huldah spend talking together? And she would talk about the things of God. So she says this to him in verse 23. She said to him, this is what the Lord, the God of Israel, says. Tell the man who sent you to come to me. This is what the Lord says. I am going to bring disaster on this place and its people. All the curses written in the book that have been read in the presence of the king of Judah, because they have forsaken me and burned incense to other gods and aroused my anger by all their hands that they have made. And my anger will be poured out on this place and it will not be quenched. Tell the king of Judah who sent you to inquire of the Lord. This is what the Lord says concerning the words you have heard. But because you were responsive and humbled yourself before God, you heard what was spoke against this place and its people. And because you humbled yourself before me and tore your robes and wept in my presence, I have heard you, declares the Lord. Now I will gather you to your ancestors, and you will be buried in peace. Your eyes will not see all the disaster that I am going to bring on this place and those who live here. So they took her answer back to the king. What impressed God? His heart was responsive and he's humbled himself. God is not, he's not impressed with how great I can pray, how much I get into the Bible and I can whoop anybody with it and tell them how, you know, doctrine and all that. He's not impressed with that. You know what he's impressed with? A humble heart. I have seen throughout the Word of God where the Word of God comes in and men are humbled. All of a sudden, whatever wrath was being poured out, God lets it subside. Let this be a lesson to all of us, young people, old people, men, women. I want us all to understand this. There is a place in God where there is safety in humility. In that place with God where we reside under his wing. Is your heart responsive this morning? New discoveries in him are made every day, every week. What do you do with it? I heard him. And I go on about my business. Do you act upon it? Does it change the way you live? Do you go on as usual, or do you stop in your tracks? Do you rip your robe? Because you realize, God, there's something here that you've spoken to me. Each step of this journey, God reveals a little bit more of himself. In Isaiah 55, 6 and 7, it says, "Seek the Lord while he may be found. Call on him while he is near. Let the wicked forsake their ways and the unrighteous their thoughts. Let them turn to the Lord and he will have mercy on them and to our God, for he will freely pardon." This is our journey of discovery. Yes, there are places where it seems difficult to understand. In fact, it seems at times, "God, it seems it's very difficult what you're saying here for me to do." Yes, you know what? He said that because he wants us to dig a little farther. He wants us to seek a little harder. Why do you think he talked in parables? Because the Pharisees did not understand, and he knew that. And they weren't supposed to understand. But to those that were supposed to hear, they had ears that were tuned to the voice of the Lord. This is our journey. The things may seem at odds, obscured, and yes, God wants us to be persistent. So what did Josiah do? He continued just like this, and it says in 2 Kings 23, "Neither before him nor after Josiah was there a king like him who turned to the Lord as he did, with all of his heart, with all of his soul, and with all of his strength, in accordance with all the law of Moses." It's interesting because Jesus uses those same words. He says, he answered, "Then love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind." Stay on path this morning. God gives us the blueprint. He does not want us to turn or swerve, keeping complete obedience. As you discover and he uncovers these places in our lives, they should bring humility and change in us. Seek his face. We need an outpouring of God in these last days. I want us to be lovers and seekers of God, and I want us to tear that spiritual robe, tear at our hearts. God, I got to be different. See, you will get what you seek for. The amount of desire, the amount of urgency, you will have that back to you. It's all up to us. This morning, our hunger will determine our level of input of God. As we close this morning, just close your eyes just for a moment. I want to pray. Heavenly Father, this morning, I pray, God, that we would not leave this place the same. God, I pray that this tears at men's hearts. I pray that this tears at women's hearts and children's hearts this morning. God, that we will not settle any longer. God, that we would stay in this place with you. God, that we would seek after you with all of our heart. We would follow you completely. We would not swerve to the right or the left. But God, we would see that this journey of discovery that you have for us, yes, there are highs and there's lows, but in the midst of all of it, God, it is a place where we can know you. Oh, Lord, do that in us this morning. God, tear at the very fabric of our hearts. I want us to be miserable this week unless we completely resolve ourselves to you like the people of Israel did after Josiah did all these things. They make a pledge to the Lord. This morning, God wants us to make that pledge to him. Lord, I pledge myself to you fully and completely. I'll stay on the path. Not swerving to the right or the left. I know there are alleys along the way that look good, but God, that I'll stay on the path with you. We thank you, Lord. Amen. I'd like you all to stand just for a moment. This morning, I know I ran just a little bit late, but I just feel like I want to open this place up this morning. As we sing this song together this morning, that if the Lord is calling you to be even more of a seeker, drawing you into that place, I want to open this place up to you this morning that you can come and say, "God, that's where I want to be. That's where I desire to be."
You ascend this day just like you said you would. Your word is not in vain. Our hearts reaching heaven. just come.
A seeker of you. I want my heart to be fully devoted to you, God. I can't be partially in. I have to be all in with you, God. Fully surrendered. Following you completely. God, let us follow. Let me follow Josiah's example. Even as a young age, God, he thirsted, he hungered after you. God, let that be the cry of our heart this morning, that we would be seekers and lovers of you, God, fully devoted, not diverting to the right or the left, but on your path. We thank you, Jesus.